Hey, welcome to a very special episode of Josh's Car Corner. The GTO and I are in Indiana right now to say goodbye to an old friend. Now, I've owned the GTO for a little over 3 years, and while it has been the best car I've ever owned, and certainly the fastest and best handling and most comfortable, it wasn't the first car that I started playing with and became a boy racer and learned about cars and stoked that fire and passion for cars and power and racing and all that. The car that taught me everything I knew about driving up to the point of owning this thing is actually sitting right over there. And this is it right here. This is a 1992 Pontiac Grand Prix sedan. Now, you may take one look at that and think, well, that's nothing very special. There are millions of these cars out there, or at least there were, and that is true. But there were a couple of things that set this thing apart. First of all, a little backstory. See, in the year 2000, I bought my first car. It was a 93 Ford Probe SE, and it was a fun car, but it only had a four-cylinder and an automatic, so the only thing it was really good at was cornering. And back then, I had the mentality of dressing my cars up. So I got the GT wheels on it, the GT spoiler, the GT rear bumper too, although I never got it on the car. And I made it look like a GT. And with those tires on it, it handled really well. It cornered unbelievably well. I really enjoyed thrashing it around turns and stuff, and it always hugged the road. But then in April, what had happened is I was driving home from work, and it was at night and it was raining, and I was crossing an overpass of a freeway, and some lady turned in front of me, and I ended up T-boning her. I didn't even see it coming because I had just looked up after adjusting the radio, and there she was. And that car got destroyed. So I was downtrodden and depressed because it was my first car, and I didn't even have it 4 months, and it was gone. And I needed something new because I was going to school, and I needed to be able to drive back and forth. So after about a week of searching, I found this car on a Ford dealer's lot in the used section. And it didn't really impress me at first because it was black, and it had that red stripe. This used to be red right here, and it had the 16-inch big five-spoke dish wheels on it that didn't really stick out, and it didn't look very impressive. And nothing caught my eye until I got to the front end here, and I saw the badge that used to be here that said 24-valve V6. And you don't just see that on a Grand Prix. That's a rare thing. Only 10% of Grand Prix produced from 91 to 96 had the 24-valve V6, known to a lot of us as the LQ1, that's the engine code, but it is the twin dual cam 3.4 liter V6 engine. I took it for a test drive and I absolutely fell in love with it. The power, it had a sunroof, which I'd never seen in a car I'd owned before. It had a driver information center that told you all kinds of goofy stuff. And when you're 20 years old, that's what matters, is cool toys and a sunroof and power. So for $5,000, I ended up buying this car with 101,000 miles on it. And for 2 years, I just drove it as my car back and forth. For winter, I got winter tires for it, and it worked absolutely fine in the winter. It never got stuck. And the only mechanical problems it gave me in those 2 years is that the fuel pump died on it. But it still worked enough for me to drive it from my house to 30 miles to the dealership I worked at the time to get the fuel pump replaced. So it never absolutely stranded me those first 2 years. It was a very reliable car. It did everything it was supposed to do. And then I graduated from college, and I got a job and came into some decent money, and I decided I wanted to do this thing up. So the first thing I did is I had it repainted. Same color, except I had the original hood all customized, and a friend of mine cut this section right along the hood line here and raised this up and created a giant cowl, and then he cut scoops into the front of it, and he painted ghost flames on it and the fenders. And when I was 22, it looked cool. But after 2 years, it was kind of ridiculous. So actually, in the end, I ended up getting rid of that hood. The hood that's on the car now is actually from a Turbo Grand Prix coupe, which is a very rare thing. They didn't make a lot of them. And they came with these giant functional heat extracting louvers, which I thought was very cool. A year after all the paintwork was done, I decided it was time to soup the motor up. Now, the factory engine came with 200 horsepower, which is pretty good for a car like this. But I took it apart, and I completely stripped it down. I took the heads off. I took them to a professional race shop. I had them ported and polished and gone through. The block took completely down, factory pistons, factory rods gone. Replaced the rods with forged small block Chevy rods because they're the same rod length as what comes factory in the car, and had some Ross forged racing pistons built for it. The factory compression was about 9 1/4. Now it's sitting around somewhere around 9.6, 9.7. And the other big improvement was ditching the factory 4-speed automatic, which was fine for cruising around, but it's not a performance transmission. First gear goes to 50, second gear goes to 90. It's not a great transmission for cruising or racing. A very limited production transmission that went in these cars was a Getrag 5-speed transmission. They only put them in about 10,000 Grand Prix and maybe about 13 or 14,000 Z34 Luminas and just a couple hundred Cutlass Supremes. Not very common. But I managed to find one in good shape and all the parts needed to swap this thing over. There's a plate on the firewall you have to take out and replace so you can mount your clutch pedal. So the whole dash had to come out of the car. I did some work on the brakes. I put stainless steel brake lines on it and got it all back together. And it took a little bit of time. I ran into problems because the problem is it wasn't a very common engine, the 3.4. I mean, you could still get parts for it in 2002 and 2003 when I was doing all this work, but some things were still kind of hard to come by. And I didn't have as much money as I needed to finish the project because I was young and I thought I could do it all on a dime. So it took longer than I wanted to get the car put together, but eventually I did get it put together. And once I got it together and the engine broken in and I got it running, it was a runner. It really pulled, it had unbelievable power and I had a blast in it. The very first thing I ended up doing in it is going to what used to be held in the Quad Cities in Illinois and Iowa. It was called the Grand Prix Gathering. It was a big thing and it was mainly for the newer Grand Prix that from 97 up that had that supercharged 3800 V6 because they're all drag racers and they were all interested in straight line power. But at those events, they did run a drag race where this thing wasn't competitive because those cars just had way more power, but they also had a parking lot autocross. And having never done it before, I beat all of them in the modified category and actually won that autocross event in 2004. I came back the next year with even more modifications to the car. I got a custom coilover setup for the rear suspension with stiffer springs and height adjustability so I could make the ride height match front to rear. And that really stiffened the back of the car up and really made it handle nice because the back end was nice and tight and the front end wouldn't understeer anymore in corners. If anything, the tail would step out a bit, which is what you want with a front wheel drive car. You don't want understeer. And that second year at the Grand Prix Gathering, I won the autocross again in the modified class by 4 seconds. So it was unbelievably quick. And also in the drag racing, it was broken down into stock and modified classes. And I won the stock class. I ended up having to chase down a bone stock supercharged Grand Prix and beat him. I actually dialed 1500s faster than he did and I had to chase him down and I won. So that year I won the autocross and the drag race and I got this awesome 6-foot trophy for doing it. I was so excited and all of a sudden this car was getting all kinds of attention from people who couldn't care less about a 92 Grand Prix before. Because it was super rare, it had that 5-speed transmission and had that twin cam V6, which was not very common. It sounded amazing, it drove amazing, it had unbelievable top end power. At the time I had a friend, and you've seen him in my videos before, he owns that white hot G8 GXP. Before he owned that, he owned a 2000 Grand Prix GTP supercharged. And we were always in a battle against each other. At the drag strip, he was always faster because he had drag tires and he could hook. But on the street, from a 60 roll, this thing was faster than his. And he had a smaller pulley and a chip, and I could still pull him from 60 on, and I'd always win that race. And that was just unbelievable to me, considering that this thing is not supercharged, and it's got a lot less torque than a 3800, but it's got that top end horsepower, and it would just pull and go and go and go right up to 7,000 RPM. That was the red line. And I took it there all the time, because with that built up motor, it could just take anything I could throw at it. I never could hurt this motor, or so I thought. What happened is in 2006, by that time I'd already been doing what's called high speed autocrossing, which is a thing that a racing association does here in the Midwest, where you go to road courses for a day and you do a one hot lap on a road course, and that's autocrossing. And I was doing that at tracks called Blackhawk Farms, which is down in northern Illinois, and then Autobahn Country Club, which is down by Joliet, Illinois, and then the Milwaukee Mile, along with being that 1 mile oval, has an infield road course, and I was going there too. Well, in 2006 at the Milwaukee Mile, and I hadn't changed the oil after doing some other previous racing and drag racing, and it didn't really occur to me, and I went out on my qualifying lap, and the oil had gotten so thin that I ended up with a rod bearing spinning, and I was able to limp the car home, but then I had to tow it back to my house and take the engine apart and replace the rod was okay, fortunately, but the crank got bent and it was junk, and the bearing got spun, so I had to take the whole thing apart again and replace those bearings and replace the crank with a crank from a 3.1 because it was the same crank. It was back up and running in 2007. And I went to the Pontiac Nationals with my buddy with the G8. I won my money back and a little sum, which every time I went to the Pontiac Nationals, I was able to do that. I was never able to win the drag racing because there's a lot of really good drag racers there, but I was always able to get my money back at least, which was nice. And I did that in 2008, drove it some more, did some more drag racing. I also upgraded the electronics in it. It was a 1992, so it had the OBD1 computer in it, which I had a friend who could tune, and I kind of understood it, but I didn't have the software or the capability to modify it myself. So I upgraded it to OBD2 so I could use my HP Tuner software to tune the car, which was a complicated process and had its hurdles. But once I got that done, then I was able to tune the car, which was a lot of fun. 2009 was the last year that I actually owned the car. And it was a really good year. I actually won 2 drag racing events. I won 2 Buick Olds Pontiac events. One of them I won at Great Lakes Dragway, which is where I actually won one in 2006 as well. So I won that Buick Olds Pontiac 2 different years. And also there was a Buick Olds Pontiac event set up at Byron Dragway in Illinois, and I won that as well. And that one, I actually had to race my buddy Joe with the G8 in the final, and I beat him. He broke out and I managed to run in within my time, and I ended up winning. At that point, he had had his G8, and he was so much faster than me now. It was ridiculous. And the car, I'd owned it for 9 years, and it was starting to get a little lacking in some areas. The headliner was starting to come off, and the cloth over the door speaker was coming off, and just little things like that. Because by then, it was a 17-year-old car. So I decided it was time to move on to something bigger and better. So I had this friend in Indiana, and I offered the car for sale, and he bought it, and he's actually owned it and kept it going for the last 4 years. He actually went down to Miami and lived down there for some time, and the car was down there. He took the 16-inch cross-lace wheels off that I had on there and put on these 17-inch wheels instead. While it was down there, they played with it. He tuned it a little more. He got the engine really refined because he knew tuning a lot better than I did at the time that I was working on this, and he got it really smoothed out and running great. And he just moved back up here a week ago to start working a new job, and he brought the car with him. But unfortunately, this is gonna be the last journey for the car. He told me that another friend of ours is buying the engine, and he's going to put it in his E34 Lumina that he is restoring and doing back up to its proper form. The transmission may go somewhere, and the rest of the car is gonna get thrown away for scrap. So I had to come down here one more time to see my old car and to say goodbye. It's something that only a real car person would understand, is the relationship you have with a car and to a car and what it means to you. Because for 9 years, this was my life. This was my baby. And I have so many great memories of being in it and driving in it and winning races and everything, that I had to come see it one more time. Now, I don't despair, because obviously I have the GTO, and the GTO is just incredible. It's such a huge leap and bound ahead of what this was. But your first real car always means something to you. And it might have not technically been my first car, but it was the car that taught me everything I know about engines and setting up suspensions and how to race and how to tune, all of that stuff. So it is it's just one of those things, and only a car person will understand it. So this is it. This was the car. that taught it all to me. So I'll have a little, I'm gonna do a little clip package of, I've got footage from racing all through the years in this thing that was shot by friends and while I was doing other things. So I'm gonna put a little clip package together here to finish this video off. But I'm glad you were here to share this with me, and I'm really glad I got to see the car one more time and say goodbye. So I hope you enjoy this episode of Josh's Car Corner, and I thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.
But it's an older non-supercharged one. It's a very quick car.